Hi everybody! Hi Noga!
Hi Gil!
Hi! So welcome to another psychoanalyzing video. Today we have a very interesting character in the story. He's very different from most of the other characters. Talking about the ex-pope of the Church of the Seven, the High Sparrow. What is the psychological thrust that takes this seemingly normative merchant into becoming an all-obsessed religious zealot? Mm-hmm. And the top pope in the land.
My father was a cobbler. He died when I was young and I took over his shop.
When he was at a dinner party with women and food and alcohol and everyone was wasted. For some people, maybe they'll hear that and say, wow, that sounds like a great evening, you know, and that would be it. And maybe that's what he told himself for a while. But at that point, he felt like it was too much.
I didn't even put on my shoes. I walked out the door and never went back.
I'm relying on Lacan's term jouissance. It's like enjoyment, and it's basically over-enjoyment. Sex and food is something that we can enjoy, but if we have too much of it, then it has nothing to do like with the life force that drives us to enjoy these
things. You're not enjoying food or sex anymore. You're just like doing it because you're like obsessed with it.
Obsessed with it. You're not enjoying it that much anymore. Exactly. I mean, many people who are sex addicts or even people who binge food and stuff like that, you don't enjoy it at one point. It hurts your stomach, you feel lousy.
It's the opposite. It's not the life force. It's like self-destruction.
So Freud said that we have two basic instincts. We have the eros, which is like the life instinct. The libido is inside the eros. It drives us to enjoy the pleasure principle.
Okay.
At one point, after World War I, to be exact, Freud discovered that there was another instinct that we have, which is like the death instinct. The death instinct is something that wants us to return to like homeostasis.
So World War I, I think I saw it in a documentary that he was like perplexed, like why do all these people just like go on to die willingly, happily, going on towards the war? They were all happy at the beginning. Mm-hmm. So maybe that was like the trigger.
Exactly. Why would people be so keen on violence and like watching fights and being in violent fights themselves or hurting themselves? Like you have people that cut themselves, etc.
Why?
Sometimes kill themselves because there is an inner wish to go back to like a static state, to like where we don't want anything. We just are. So.
Like Nirvana.
It was a feast. I bought old fine wine and young pretty girls and invited my friends to come and share it.
It's negative, right? It's not like the nice Nirvana mother-infant sort of experience.
Okay, so he wasn't there, like the High Sparrow wasn't there and contemplating like the Buddha beneath the tree and then said, you know what? I figured it out. It was like an aversion that he felt that he was like rotten in some way.
Exactly.
It must have been so strong that he went all the other way, became like a born-again Christian. Mm-hmm. There's a saying in Hebrew that says that where there are like born-again religious Jews, nobody can be righteous enough because they are so extreme in their interpretation.
Right.
Which it's different if you grew up religious, right? Mm-hmm. And then maybe it's more organic. So maybe that's why he became like such a zealot regarding everybody else.
He needs religion like toddlers need their hug. You know, it's like the big other, the symbolic other that just hugs you and makes you feel like everything's okay.
Okay, and holds everything in.
We don't know enough about him, but maybe that's his tendency to go to extremes. And he was very extreme at one point, so he goes to the other extreme. But by that extremeness, he's denying all the like the gray parts. Which basically constructs
also the great parts.
Also the great parts, right. Which basically construct part of the human experience. Most people are not that extreme. Most people can enjoy sex, a good meal, without
wine.
Exactly, without being alcoholics and without binge eating. But he is taking, he's applying his own experience to the rest of the people. And
which is saying, very religious.
Which is very religious, right? And he's presenting it as the only way, as the only proper way to lead your life.
Right, because of his own issues. I don't like gay sex. So nobody should have gay sex ever, because it's horrible, because I don't like it.
I don't like it, and how can I tell my kids about it? I don't know how to talk to my kids about it, so why should...
So just like ban everybody.
Yeah, exactly.
No gays.
No gays. It also comes from a certain structure and personality, because not everyone would think that their own experience or their own thinking has to be applied to everyone else in the region.
Right, so what kind of person thinks that?
We've decided the Bible is the word of God. We don't have to have a general assembly about what we believe. It's written in the Bible.
So probably very grandiose people, people that see themselves as, you know, or are convincing themselves that they have the answer, right?
Right.
In Hebrew, being born again as a Jew is having an answer.
Baal Tshuva, yeah. Right. So he has all the answers.
He has all the answers, and now other people can come to him and receive those answers.
Right.
Together, we announce a new age of harmony, a holy alliance between the crown and the faith.
But he's humble in the way that he's like, I'm just like a vehicle, right? It's not me, I'm not God.
I serve the gods. The gods demand justice.
How do they communicate their demands? By raven or horse?
By the holy text, the seven-pointed star.
And it's not even me. He's like, the way he presents itself is like as if he's like an amalgamation of this entire movement in the books. It's more apparent, like it's like country nationwide, this thing. Mm-hmm. So it's like, it's not me, John, Paul, whatever his name is. He's like the High Sparrow. He's like the avatar of everybody. So he makes it seem as if it's not about him, but in another way, it is about him.
It is about him, probably. It's probably about him because even though he is not God, he is the chosen one, you know, the one who was chosen to be that vehicle.
Technically, he was chosen
technically,
even.
Technically, yeah.
Voted,
yeah. We have some examples in history of leaders who thought they were the only thing that this that their country needs in order to be rescued. And it's like, people think the Messiah complex, you know, it's just a different... This is like another kind of religion, politics. And
people who have that, usually they tend to move up the ladder because they're so driven. And they have this self-belief.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I think the only moment since he started his conversion that, like, he thought he was, like, the most important person there, and he was, like, manipulating the queen and the king and everybody. And at the very last second, when he understood that Cersei was not coming... And that everything that he did was meaningless. She won. Mm-hmm. It means that everything was for naught. You could see, like, in his face, he was like, so everything, like, so, like, he was searching for meaning, but no, it's nothing. I'm just like another pawn in her story.
Mm-hmm.
Boof, blew up.
Yeah. And that's
tragic.
It's tragic. And what you said about the meaninglessness, it's also what George R. R. Martin, I think, wanted to show, that, okay, he sees himself as this kind of vehicle, so that probably means that even after he's gone, this kind of movement will continue. Mm-hmm. But no, it was all about him. It was all around this kind of charismatic personality, and it was meaningless.
Right. And you created this way, that it's you, and then everybody else is a soldier.
Mm-hmm.
You didn't create like a hierarchy...
Right.
In order for that to be sustainable.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Okay.
But what is this kind of motivation? Why is he so driven? It could have something to do with the Kleinians call the manic defense, denying your vulnerability, denying the meaninglessness of our existence. You know, it's like
if it doesn't have meaning, then it's like it's too threatening.
Too threatening, intolerable. Then you go back to being that merchant at at the table with the spilled bottles of wine and naked women lying around.
Right,
everywhere.
You can't just like Netflix and chill. You don't. If I go back, it's all the way.
Right, exactly.
The gold I had, the wine I drank, the women I used, my ceaseless struggle to maintain my position.
Then you're rotten again from the inside, like you said.
It's weird. Now I talked myself into not liking him, even though I'm actually for him. He's a much better leader for me than everybody else out there. Cersei, for sure, she's a terrorist, crazy terrorist, just kills everybody, doesn't care. Less people would be hurt if it was a theocracy. I'm not for a theocracy, but if it's either that or feudalism, mm-hmm. I'll take the theocracy.
If we take what you said about him being an activist at face value, then we can say, okay, maybe psychotherapy still doesn't know how to contain this kind of phenomena, because everything is considered a symptom.
Okay.
So even his activism could be considered a symptom, like we said, manic defense, not being able to face the meaninglessness of existence.
So if we agree that he's doing good, for the sake of the argument, then that too is a problem. Doing good, wanting to change society, it's a psychological problem.
Could be the psychological problem of the individual. But the solution for the collective, I mean, there are situations like that. And
right, only crazy people change the world.
Yeah, maybe.
Yeah, because you have to be crazy to go into that.
Right, you have to be really motivated.
And we as a people will get to the promised land. So I'm happy tonight, I'm not worried about anything. I'm not fearing any man. Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord.
God's laws must be applied to all equally.
We have to also separate between violence and aggression. Aggression is not necessarily violence. Aggression is what is like what drives us to move forward. I mean, we can't do anything. We can't change anything without aggression. If someone doesn't have any aggression in them, then they will be very feeble, very, you know, passive in that sense.
Right, so like a vegetative state or something.
Exactly. You need the aggression to move forward. And
he's maybe, if you compare him, like, his kind of violence to the violence of the 1%, you can say that he's mostly acting out of self-defense,
right?
In a, according to the rules of the game that are violent, he has to have weapons in order to free the people, to give them more rights.
Yeah, you could say that, and you could also say that change doesn't come without aggression, without hurting. Someone will be hurt. People will lose their privileges, people will lose things, other people will gain stuff. I mean,
people will be offended.
Exactly. Exactly. What can you do? I mean, we have to be wounders in a way in order to heal.
It's maybe like you can apply that to the Me Too movement campaign, Time's Up. It's like, it's very aggressive, but is it violent?
The radical Democrats have turned into an angry mob.
We refuse to be intimidated by the mob of people.
No to mob rule.
If you compare it to the violence against women,
physical violence, economic violence, political violence,
so many forms of violence against women.
I think that you can't change the world without some sort of aggression and violence. If you would just like sit here and say, let the 1% give me my rights. Let the men give me equal opportunity. Let the straight people give me that. Let the white people give me that. Then just it doesn't work this way. Mm-hmm. You have to use the tools of this world in your disposal.
Taking into consideration that the language of religion and religious belief is very different than the language of psychotherapy. Mm. And so sometimes there's also a clash between languages, and it's difficult to agree on the basic assumptions that will allow us to form some kind of a working alliance.
Right, because his motivations would be divine in his eyes. How
and
can
I'm
you bridge
just,
that?
Well, it's very difficult. A lot of trust, a lot of listening, a lot of debating.
I think you can do that.
I can do anything, yeah.
Okay, so thank you everybody for watching. Subscribe to get all our videos. Check out our Patreon page on patreon.com/geotechacademy. And we'll see you all next time. Bye, everybody.
Bye.
I just want to do God's will. And he's allowed me to go up to the mountain. And I've looked over. And I've seen the promised land.